Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Indira Ghosh from Jawaharlal Nehru University. Today we will be discussing about the chemoinformatics and chemical databases under the paper Computational Biology. Today's learning objective is to do the learning about the chemical database, how it has been historically growing, how the chemical notations have come into existence, also the searching techniques and how the small molecule modeling has been a part of this subject, which has emerged as chemical informatics or chemoinformatics. Now, today we will be learning mostly about the history of subject called chemoinformatics, how it has grown up, and it started way back very much in 18th century or very well. As it has grown up, how computers took the major part and role to elaborate these chemical notations. We'll be also learning what are the features or what are the new things, activities are happening in chemistry and associated with chemical information service, like CAS, which is Chemical Abstract System or services, how it has been connected with computers, and also we will be learning to compare between how the bioinformatics subject, which is similar protein, similar function, how it correlates the similarity between chemicals and interaction with biology. So I will give you most of these topics in the next few slides and discuss about it. We will discuss about what is chemical information systems, and from that we derive this word called chemoinformatics. The history actually starts way back in sometimes in 1832, when the first published paper came as Annales de Pharmacie, and in all over the world, the chemical abstract started 1907, which made it to be as quickly as possible to be computer related, and which was around 50 years it took. So 1957, first time chemical abstract can be read and information can be disseminated. This was the emergence of this chemoinformatics, and mainly it is chemical information management, chemical informatics. Sometimes we call it chemo, sometimes we call it chemi informatics. However, detail of this history has been collected and written, and the web link shows that. We would like to inform you about what is chemoinformatics. As you know, that chemoinformatics is a mixing of these informations which is required for drug discovery process, which has been elaborated by F.K. Brown in Annual Reports in Medicinal Chemistry in 1998. However, during this period, the definition or what is chemoinformatics has been clearly mentioned in other texts, which you can see in your websites, which is designing, creation, organization, management, retrieval, analysis, and dissemination, in addition to visualization, which are the most important factors to understand about the drug discovery process. However, by Mike Kahn, who is the director of, used to be the director of Glaxo, for a long time was associated with this field, has said, chemoinformatics, a new name for an old problem. The milestone in the field of chemoinformatics are that it started the representing the chemical structures into linear notations and different kind of representations. Also to do with how efficiently we can do the searching of the chemicals, similarity between one chemical query to plenty of database structures, some fragment and substructure searchings, development of different type of diverse libraries, or analyzing the high throughput screening. Similarly, many of features like 3D substructure functioning, Also, it includes and have an important role to play in quantitative structure and activity relationship. We will go through several modules to depict and disseminate to you the information related in chemistry, chemical structures, and the biological relevance of these structures. Now, we will talk about how this has evolved and what was the beginning of chemical information. So, the beginning of chemical information actually started searching by atoms. So, one wants to know what is the content of a chemicals. One can write this as a formula and can use that by atom, like hydrogen, how many hydrogen atom contains in these chemicals, how many oxygens. However, that was not sufficient to extract analytical information, and so there was necessity. We should actually express them in some kind of notation or representation, and because of that, Wieser line notation came out. This Wieser's line notations will be described later slide, how it is, the rules and how it shows. However, chemical abstract services also started during the same time anyways by NSF funding. For the chemical information collection, one became very easy for the users to read the information, convert it into different kind of searching algorithm. And here came, within few years, the first algorithm associated with chemical information called Morgan algorithm, which actually uses graph theory, which I will speak in the next modules. However, that was the starting of conversion of chemistry or chemical information into the computer language. Here I show you how the coding of WLN is done, which was the preliminary. Later, at least nowadays and present system, we are not using WLN coding. However, a lot of programs developed during 70s and early 80s followed WLN coding. It used to be very simple. And how the coding done? If you define a set of rules, like here we have defined, like hydrogen would be used like H. And the rule is, we will use capital letters for A to Z, used for elements, atom groups, branch, ring, etc. We will use numbers, and those will be indicating length of the alkyl chain or length, a ring number, etc. Some special characters also indicate certain rings and substitution positions. Here are simple three application which I have shown here. Hydrogen, normally it is H in our chemical structure depiction, whereas in WLN code it's also H. Alkanes are represented as H2C, CH2, and they would be explained as U, whereas alkynes has to be C3 and UU. Alcohols, ethers are like hydroxyl, oxygen. You can represent hydroxyl, then it is used one letter called Q. And if it is a ether, oxygen, then it will be only O. Here we can run through this, and can we depict everything uniquely? And that's the problem. Two structures shown on the right hand side are actually can be depicted by two words. One is 2OV1 or 1VO2. Here you see, if we write a program, both of them cannot be used by computer, those days at least, to use as one structure, which I can depict on the first one or second one. However, it has been decided just the 2OV1 should be used. Hence, the coding becomes, WLN coding has lot of limitations. You can read all these more in the books shown in the next slides. Molecular structure now comes. Once we represent them, we must first know what is the things which we are going to represent in WLN. This constitutes a sequence of bonding atoms. Hence, please do note, you cannot have a structure which is not bonded between them. Then those two will be called as two different structures. Also, you can express them by topological descriptors. These descriptors would be taken also in next modules. we can also be sure, and one has to be keeping the chemistry intact, we should have a spatial arrangement of atoms, and that is called configuration. This is expressed mostly by shape, volume, descriptors, etc. within the 3D spatial configuration. And this is very unique for every molecular structure. Next comes another word called conformation. What are the conformation? They are, for the same molecule, we can have several conformations. Mostly it is well known that thermodynamically stable spatial arrangements are accepted as different conformation. These are expected as a quantitative molecular structure descriptors because their topology will be different, their shape will be different. However, their physicochemical properties may not be different. Also, one can compare these conformations between different structures or different molecules by their comparison between two molecules by similarity coefficients. We will be discussing that also later. How to represent molecular structure or chemical structure? All of you are very well aware of simple chemical depiction of a molecule, like which is nothing but how many atoms present. C8H9NO3. However, it does not tell what molecule it is. Hence, we take more steps by using if we connect or depict them by how they are connected between atoms. If we connect them by each of the atoms, which is shown in the next right side, you would expect little more information by this depiction. If we go to the next slide, we see here. Bond types are also depicted here, which distinguishes a single bond and double bond and aromatic bonds, which also depicts the physicochemical property of the chemical structures. Can we go more beyond? Yes, because every chemical structure must have a stereochemical configuration, which is shown by the ring going away from us and the amide or NH2 bond is going on the towards us. These are the stereochemical configuration of this molecule, and very easily now you can say, oh, this is nothing but a phenylalanine. Yes, you are right, it is phenylalanine. Now, this explains the chemical structure, but it does not explain all the physicochemical property of a chemical structure. And why they are important? Because we are looking for interaction of these chemical structures with the biological effects. Hence, we should be looking for what are the charged atoms. Here I shown you on oxygen or carbonyl oxygen, you have one carbonyl and one carboxyl. Carboxyl oxygen is negatively charged, whereas the amide is positively charged. So one can depict some structures, and one would like to represent a chemical structures showing these properties. Now we are going another property. We can even tag a chemical whether that has an isotope. And this is very important because a lot of interactions of chemicals are identified by the isotopes. Especially when we do the structural elucidation, we use these for NMR or in nuclear magnetic resonance systems, we use them. Next comes, can we depict more than only a simple chemical 1D structure, which I have shown here? Actually, the molecule is not in this form, which I will try to represent after a while. Here comes. So, what has been achieved till middle of 1980s or beginning of 1980s was that there were a lot of algorithm for this small substructure searching has been introduced, which includes atom by atom. It includes search tree. It also had lot of insufficiency in doing this substructure searching very fast. This needed that we should have a strategy to make this development faster. Hence, a lot of algorithm came out online on computer in 1980. Also, to search for all the chemical abstracts available called CAS registry system, where most of the published papers should having chemistry and chemical reaction and chemical structures must be enrolled in CAS registry system, and they should be available for computer to search the structure. It helped a lot in the subject of chemical informatics and analysis of chemical informatics. One of the important fields is substructure search, and this is to be highly constrained because substructure must contain appropriate chemical connectivity and retain the chemical connectivity inclusive of double bond, single bond, etc. This is why one was looking for substructure. Need not say why this is very beautiful to have a similarity measure. Why? Because basic principle is similar property principle or neighborhood behavior. If the two structures are very similar, they should be having very much near biological properties. In drug designing, you all be understanding why it was looked for, that similar chemical structures can be identified. There are two, three different kind of methods which we'll elaborate in next module. However, it is very much graph-based approach, and that has become very popular recently, which is called maximal common substructure. Another method is fragment-based method, which also can be depicted later about structurally not absolutely connected. However, depending on their importance, the fragments can be measured and depicted, represented enough, and which has been a very good Lederle and Pfizer's lead to do the similarity search. I would like to describe how storage and retrieval became important because of the huge amount of publications. All these structures, not only we required the 1D structures, we required the abstract informations, we required to keep their reaction, how they can be made, synthesized. And it increased enormously the data, and that's why the computer also were utilized. Fortunately for us, the computer development in 1980s and 90s were very much harmonized with this huge explosion of data. More explosion came in later part of 80s and beginning of 90s when the techniques in synthesis, a newer technique came out called combinatorial chemistry. That is, you can synthesize many one-pot reaction or maybe two-pot reaction. However, at a time, one can synthesize not one substituent molecule but many of the analogs. Similarly, data explosion came in biological sciences with high throughput screening. One started actually finding not only one type of molecule and one inhibitions. However, they started at a time 96 well plate, 96 data at one time assay. And these demanded a huge amount of chemical information to be integrated with biological information. Hence, I will show you a very simple concept which can be utilized and has been shown in the paper, and I have taken the picture. Just by if you look at just the publication by the wave of knowledge per year, which contains molecular similarity, just that much, two words. It's very interesting. You can see the titles are shown with dark color, and the grayish color shows the abstracts that keyword contains. It's enormously increased from 1990s, that is 92-93 onwards in 2003. It is enormously increasing even today, and the number of publications is not only in, this has been shown in kilobyte, that means 90,000 publication on the left hand side per year has been published, around 80,000 here in 2003, which contains this word called molecular similarity. This is a very good show that people started using, and mostly the researchers started using the CASH, that is chemical abstract system, searching similar molecules and input them to synthesize. Here I show you substructure searching. So there are small queries, then you can have many substructure searching. And here it shows on the red color all the slides, all those part of the molecule which are very much associated with the substructure searching. I show you the 2D similarity searching, and that is similar structure has been identified as a part or exact similar to different molecules shown here, like five of the molecules are shown here, which has almost similar, not almost exact similar structure, which is shown in the query molecule here. Both of these are extracted from large databases. But why similarity is important? I already mentioned the biological importance. Here I show you by experimental data. The fingerprint similarity between morphine, codeine and heroin is 99% in case of morphine and codeine. And in case of heroin, it is morphine and heroin is 95%. And all the three inhibitors are almost equal inhibition constant for the dopamine receptors, which are very important in drug, well known very well in the drug and this. However, the chemist synthesized a molecule which I'm going to show called methadone, which is a part of a molecule which also brings certain extent the similar effect or biological effect, but not to the greater extent. And it shows here that methadone has 20% similarity structure with the morphine. Here it's a very ideal case where the molecules having similar structures as best similarity or neighborhood effect, they have the biological similar effect. Whereas methadone, which is little farther, is not necessarily having this exact similar, much less effect on that. So we need to have similarity measure, but there are certain difficulties that we must have some quantifying method which should be actually used as unique method. Unfortunately, similarity can be measured by different ways. And you can have, if you take three fruits, you can have three different similarities. Let us say you take orange, apple, and banana. If you have banana and orange, their color almost similar, but apple is not. If you think of the apple and banana, it is almost similar in taste, but oranges are not. Hence, as you know this by common senses, you cannot have one similarity measure, but you can have several similarity measures, which I will show you next slide. There are developed from last 30 years or so many similarity measures, almost 22 to 23 indexes. Here I show you a bunch of index which has been actually evaluated by the groups in Holiday and other et al, where it has been found these are very unique and can be depicted by any method, would be respectively find beautiful systems of similarity in their biological property. Most important to note that you have some of the Jacquard or Tanimoto, which is most popular coefficient, seems to be association related. That means two similar properties of two similar molecules or chemicals have the similar properties also. However, there are some of them which are not really associative with them, and that is if you look at the Yule function, which is all YUL and AD minus BC divided by AD plus BC. Now, what is ABC? A is the number of bits common to both the compounds, and B or C are the number of bits unique to the query of or the database compounds. Hence, you can calculate these values and you can depict them with the correlation or maybe association. Both the cases, it found to be very good measure of similarity. However, we must know to do the comparison of similarity coefficient, and what are those? Only need to consider hardly 12 or 13 as the method has depicted here. So one can pick up one target structure, use all the decreasing order chemical database with 22 different similarity coefficient, then you look at which are more clustering, coming the similar coefficients. And in that was found that most of them, other than 12 or 13, which is shown in your previous slide, are near monotonic in behavior. Hence, we can actually do that much. How to do the similarity searching? Now, what we actually want to do is search for a query molecule and find very similar molecules in large data structures, or given a set of compounds, you would like to search what are the similarity between the set of compounds and my query compounds. The beautiful importance is this kind of searching is that one just need the structure or the line notation even for the structure. However, it does not need to build costly pharmacophore or doesn't need to use too much of computer services. Very fast algorithms are known. Also, it does not need a lot of understanding on the subject. That is, you do not need to know the physicochemical properties of the molecules. So doing this fast searching, this method is very beautiful and elegant to identify, and very advantageous for identifying subset of compounds. In this, you can actually do clustering. You can as well do some kind of hierarchical system of clustering. So you can find which are the nearest neighbor, not only that, who are the distant neighbor. So these advantages makes this similarity calculation very useful for searching for new compounds in the databases. This slide, we actually put out to you the slides for most popularly used and very useful three of the coefficient for measuring similarity. And why these are so important? Because most often we use Tanimoto coefficient, and Tanimoto coefficient found to be very relevant for biological property relationship because it has a association component. Hamming distance is another one which is very simple and calculation is very easy, as well as cosine coefficient. Now these tools have been found to be beautifully utilized and hard, you know, very easy to program and calculation for a huge amount of data. However, these also, like other more complicated expressions, still have a bias towards the size distribution of the amount of chemicals. The size is larger, the size of the molecules, these calculations become very much dependent. And while similarity searching, it becomes a different strategy to use. Hence, to improve that, one uses either complementary type of coefficient together, or one uses some intelligent fusion techniques, which I will skip this time. But its efficiency should be very good in both of them. Now to talk about what are the current activities in chemoinformatics, where it is applied. Mostly, as I said, it has been applied earlier for keeping the chemical abstract system, synthesis systems, how to do the chemical synthetic chemicals relevance for biological properties. However, last 20-30 years, one uses huge database searching, virtual screening, and that application has got not only to do similarity, also to do something like dissimilarity based. Most often for virtual screening, one likes to have diverse chemicals, which is used by these three rules. Select the compound and data set randomly, start and go on calculating the dissimilar values and components, and then you create the substrate until you get required amount of compounds. This have been actually been actively used in drug designing. As you see here, different companies who produces lot of this device tools for doing software, as well as they collect and divine new compounds, mostly new compounds for appropriate structural representation, sometimes selecting set of known molecules, sometimes quantifying the diversity. Here is a plot. If you take a real diverse compounds, you would never get a plot like this. However, commonly used chemical compounds, if one does a high throughput screening, you can very well see the compounds are clubbed together between 0 to 20% to 30% all the set of compounds inhibition percentage. Such a kind is a very useless for doing large amount of chemicals wastage as well as large amount of assay wastage. To recover from that, one use the diversity analysis of chemicals, and then one gets the plots beyond 20 to 60, which one would be interested, because you would like to design some inhibitors which are more than 50% inhibition at certain concentration. Now I'll come to that, where this kind of virtual screening are applied. Druggability consideration, similarity in searching, many structure or substructure searching, pharmacophore pattern searching, as well as in docking. How one does the better of, how one knows, that's called enrichment factor, which is shown here by the expressions. That is, if you contain N molecule data set, then NA divided by N and N capital NA divided by N also gives you active and how many active molecules existing, and how best the higher the value you get means your enrichment factors are increasing. Next is our slide for what are the challenges in the field. How much we can filter for properties like ADMET, because we are not very sure to have many reactions using one same chemicals happens in biological, particularly in biological experiments like ADMET or toxicity. How we improvise the new scoring function, which should be related more to the functional features of substructure rather than not the other parts. Similarly, data tools, because huge explosion, one needs a faster methods for data mining and searching. New tools for decision trees. Many people are working on how to collect the information, quickly process the information, and calculate the quantitatively values to tag or annotate systems. Also, material science, food science, atmospheric chemistry, and polymer chemistry has been in the line of application of chemoinformatics recent. I will show you two slides which actually says how the relation between chemoinformatics and bioinformatics. In bioinformatics, this similarity is done by very well-known BLAST algorithm, alignment algorithm. However, here is a table which shows two different fingerprints or two different ways of measuring the similarity, and three different 1, 2, 3 on the top, which shows DHFR, a bioactive molecule that is very good drug target, and GERD, which is also a very bioactive molecule. Two different receptors, how they perform. As you see here, a number of compounds by any of the fingerprints seems to be recognizing pharmacologically relevant relationships. And the case of the next is 5-HT3 and 5-HT4. They are related by their ligand base. However, taken their bioinformatics tools, these two sequence alignment and structural alignment are not very much related to each other. Here shows the interaction or correlation of plot of chemo and bio. On the top line, that's rho, shows the known Cyblast, CI, etc. And daylight unity are our chemical tools. Here you see there is absolutely very poor correlation between actual biosimilarities, biosimilar molecules versus the chemosimilar molecules. However, the chemical molecules are more important than biological, only biological similar, because they are the chemicals which will be drugs. More than 40% ligand sets in one of the very important database are associated with GPCR. However, GPCR's identity is not so similar as found. So, from this comparison of bioinformatics based alignment and chemoinformatics based similarity, we came to conclusion that there is nothing called a ranking between the interactions can be done. Also, we came to understand that many cases, chemical similarity actually based on its pharmacological property, hence they are more trustworthy in drug designing rather than using the bio-based, sequence-based, or even structure-based similarity. These type of interactions matrices can be utilized in finding new compounds, also to find who are the distant neighbors of biological database or biological space. So, the first journal came into this effect is after all the study as had been shown, the Journal of Chemical Documentation, which was started in 1961. Presently, the equivalent journal is running as called Journal of Chemical Information and Computer Simulations, which has been changed as Chemical Informatics. Also, the very much subject-wise book came in 1971, which says Computer Handling of Chemical Structures. However, till 2000, there was no course available on chemoinformatics, and very surprisingly, now there is a big demand in not only in application world like drug designing, etc., as well as the contributions from academics. Many courses are floating now. Since 2000, the courses started. Hence, I would like to bring to your notice that chemoinformatics has emerged as a very important field in drug designing associated with bioinformatics and computational biology, hand in hand with medicinal chemistry. And this application field has got its own relevance and importance in academic as well as application world. Thank you very much for listening the whole module.